Hi there, my name is Quincee and I make chatty videos about life and popular culture every Tuesday, Thursday, and Saturday. Please consider subscribing and liking this video to let me know that you like this content. If y'all remember last week, then you know that we left off with Katie telling Matt about all the drama, toxicity, and bullying that's been going on in the house. We come back into this episode with the same energy. The OGs are just talking mess, they're calling the girls JV, they're saying they're nothing. They're saying they're disgusting. All these things, I'm like, okay, I get it. It sucks. The situation is not fun in a lot of ways, but suck it up and realize, like I said last week, this is producer work at play. You don't need to get mad at the pawns. Get mad at the king and the queen, okay? ABC production. Get it to your head. This is a television show. Come on. The girls are looking so tense amongst each other around the couches, but it is so funny. When Matt walks in, they're all, hi, like their little whispering voices. In a lot of cases, I get really grossed out when I see a woman, how they are amongst other women, and then how they are around a man that they're trying to impress. Of course, we're gonna shift some things, but ultimately you still wanna be who you authentically are. And a lot of these girls put this great front up when the cameras are on and when Matt is around. So now it gets good because Matt finally addresses everything he heard from Katie about all the bullying going on to the women. Note that he does not say her name. He just says it's been brought to his attention during the group date that Katie just happened to be on. So it's gonna come out eventually. Once he leaves and has said his piece, we have Anna. She's making these faces like, oh my God, I'm about to get found out. And then everyone's like, what? Who said that? Toxicity? Bullying? Like, where did that happen? Like, that is not how the house is. Specifically, we have MJ telling Anna, go talk to Matt. Let him know there is no kind of bullying going on, ma'am. If you feel so pressed to do that, you have to be covering something. But it doesn't even matter because we already know who said what and what y'all did. So you really can't say anything at this point. Speaking of there not really being anything left to say, Matt pulls Anna aside. The waterworks happen. There's the wiping of the tears. She's sobbing because she know what's about to happen. You about to get your butt sent home. I have never, ever found Matt James this attractive before in my life. Like, ladies and gentlemen, this is how you respond to childish behavior, especially from grown women. And I just hope and I pray that this action that he took has just sent a message to all the ladies, what will be tolerated and what will not be tolerated. Yes, this is reality TV, but this is not the Bad Girls Club. If you wanted to fight and pull hair and bully, go to Bravo, okay? Oxygen, not ABC, okay? This is not the channel. We're here for love and a little bit drama, but tasteful drama. I also find it so hilarious that at all times there is always a SUV, a minivan just parked outside on standby for wherever girl gets sent home in the middle of the day. It don't matter. They're gonna be outside waiting for you to send you to the airport. They are never pulling up, just arriving. They are there. Like, that's the type of job I want. The part that showed the truest colors of a lot of these women is when they first bold face just said, there's no bullying going on. What are you talking about? And then y'all seeing someone get sent home who y'all know is a bully and started this whole mess. Now y'all want to go to the people and apologize and y'all have all these things. Okay, well, when I said that joke, I didn't mean it. It was just like a thing. You know, we were going to get close eventually. You know, you got to do a little hazing, you know? But y'all know why they are doing this because they saw Anna get sent home and now y'all want to save face. 5 seconds ago, there was no bullying to be spoken of, but now you have something to apologize for. One thing in particular about a lot of these women just saying that there is no bullying to be spoken of is such a way to gaslight people and their experience. Because don't gaslight people who are clearly feeling uncomfortable and ostracized, and you just sitting there like, well, I ain't dealing with it, so Hands down, the worst and driest apology goes to our Queen Victoria. But then when Ryan actually speaks to Matt, she doesn't miss a detail, honey. Of the little bit that we've seen of Ryan, I really like her because she admits to Victoria, yes, I told him exactly what went on, how you called me a hoe, and all these things, and Victoria is furious. She just walks away from her. In her confessional, she's like, everything was literally going fine. But again, she gets around Matt and she softens up. She says the dumbest excuse I've ever heard when he addresses that Victoria called Ryan a hoe. And she's like, no, like, I called her a hoe out of context? Okay, in what context would calling somebody that be appropriate? Victoria has nothing to say and nothing to add because she knows she is wrong. I specifically noticed how Matt, when he was talking to her, he did let it slip that it was Katie who said it, which is fine because I don't think she's hiding it, but I would have liked if Katie could have said that herself. Then Matt just totally walks away from Victoria and then proceeds to end the cocktail party. Let's not forget to mention that Victoria has called these women every name in the book, but she gets called toxic and a bully, and that is the end of the world for her. I just hate how people can dish it, but they cannot take it. Victoria goes outside, she starts breaking down Sarah style and starts bad-mouthing everyone, and everyone can hear her bad-mouthing them. Like, I'm literally the only one that can marry him. I'm the only one with a brain. Like, literally, I die. One of the pettiest parts of the night was during the rose ceremony when the first two girls that get roses are some of the new girls. The mean, softy girls of the night are hurt right now. At the end of this rose ceremony, it felt like 12 girls left. Finally, we have people who are leaving. And out of those 100 girls that left, Victoria is one of them. Hallelujah! All of the 50 girls hugging him, saying goodbye, trying to be really nice, you know, trying to keep it cute so we can be on Bachelors in Paradise. But when it's Victoria's turn, she has her arms crossed and she's like, I feel sorry for you for listening to hearsay and not the facts. Ma'am, please get your peek-a-boo, new bra, and your bad attitude out of here. I'm tired of that. Get the SUV, please. During one of her last confessionals, thank the heavens, she says, I will never date another Matt in my life. Maybe I'm just crazy, but I swore she was about to say, I'm never dating another black man in my life. Luckily, that's not what she said. She's crazy, but she's not that crazy. Y'all, why the next day Chris Harrison says that they are past the halfway mark? I'm looking at these 75 girls, I don't know half of their names, and you're telling me that we are halfway to a marriage? To a proposal? Half of these women don't even know this man's middle name, so how are we that close to an engagement? But anyways, we find out that Rachel gets a one-on-one. She gets this really cool shopping spree where she gets these gowns and she gets some red bottoms. She is just dumbfounded and she's blushing. If I could pick one day out of the Bachelor franchise, it might be the shopping dates. Those are good, especially if they're out the country and they're going somewhere exotic and just luxurious. I am all here for it. It's either that or one of the dates where you meet somebody in their personal life, whether that's going to have dinner with them or going to their home. Those are like top-notch dates for me. Y'all can keep the skydiving and the weird contests and athleticism. That's for the birds. That's not why I came to the Bachelor if I ever got on it, which I will not. Anyway, so they're trying on these outfits. There's a part where the stylist says, I love a black and white story. And it was talking about the outfits, but I just thought that was very funny and I cackled. So Rachel heads back to the chateau, arms just full of shopping bags. The girls are so jealous, especially when they see those red bottoms. I don't even want to date Matt James and I'm jealous. It's just because of the clothes and the shoes, really. And next we see that they name all the people going on the next group date and they figure out that Kit is going to get the next one-on-one. At this point, anytime someone gets a one-on-one, everybody is questioning themselves and wanting to cry. I just feel for these poor women. So now it's a dinner party portion of the date with Rachel and Matt. Rachel is opening up about her lack of self-confidence and it's just coming across really genuine. I really like her and clearly so does Matt, but some of the speculations outside in her personal world are a little concerning. But anyway, I just hope if they do end up together that it works out. I guess Rachel got the memo about them being past halfway mark because she opens up and says that she's falling in love with him and he reciprocates, which I'm not surprised about because I feel like he's about to do that with all the girls left over. Like, of course, I'm so happy for them, genuinely happy for them, but I'm also very nervous because I'm getting this vibe that I need to mentally prepare myself for him to say it to like 10 women. And it is those late in the season heartbreaks that really get to me. It's the ones where they genuinely have a connection and they opened up and the lead told them that they feel the same way. It's just a lot. I don't want him to put that many women through that. So now there's a group date at a farm. A lot of girls are not feeling it. MJ is making it known that she is on this group date. She wants the attention. She wants the time with Matt, but it is very short-lived. Matt and MJ are having this cute little banter together. Matt just starts jogging towards her and I think they're about to embrace or something. No, he keeps jogging, sees another girl, starts making out with her, and MJ sees all of it because she thought they were in the middle of some cute little thing. And he was like, oh yeah, that was fun. Let me go to this girl real quick. A part of me was a little surprised it didn't start more of an issue because there were also women waiting for him to return back and they were making out for a good minute right there. There's this really heartfelt moment between Abigail and Matt when she opens up about if they were to have kids, there is a possibility that they could be deaf as well. It was just so hard for her to talk about that, especially because her father abandoned her family around the time that the diagnosis came up for her and her sister. So it was really interesting seeing them bond over that struggle of not having present fathers in their lives. Honestly, if I had to summarize this group date, it's just a lot of women needing reassurance because they are stressed out, and Matt is giving reassurance to every single woman. He lays it all out there. He tells them individually what specific things that he likes. He is not vague with it. So I feel like if I heard that, I'd be like, I'm winning this whole thing. Mind you, he told all the other women the same thing. So I'm not against it. I think he's really following his heart, but I'm just a little concerned. Let me know if I'm tripping. Please. Some more drama gets added when Matt addresses to MJ about her being a bully. She is fuming when she goes back to other ladies and deflecting left and right when they let her know, yes, you have been an antagonist, and she cannot take it. She came in hot and loaded and then ended just like, I feel so attacked right now. I personally get the vibe she is not the type of person you want to get in a disagreement with. It just wouldn't go anywhere. And have you noticed how mean the mean girls get when they're called out for being mean? Like, if I was MJ, I would soften up, be like, what are you talking about? Me? I'm so nice. We're like best friends. We're like roommates. Why are you acting like this? Remember when I braided your hair? Remember that moment when we both got the rose? Like, we're friends. Like, you have to play like you're dumb. Like, that moment, I was kidding. Like, I thought we were, oh my gosh. Like, don't come with the energy because they just gonna expose you more. Now they have no reason to hold back to Matt about your foolishness. Play dumb. We see what feels like a kind of short version of Kit and Matt's date together. It is really cute. They're making cookies together. I think they made dinner. She opens up about some of her insecurities with opening up to people and relationships. It was really cool because it was a moment where I liked her. I could see why Matt likes her. He is always smiling around her, clearly very interested. But I really want to know, who is he not interested in? I feel like that would be an easier question at this point. But then there is another card. Matt wants to speak to Yesenia and MJ prior to the cocktail party. There is this weird scene right after that happens where Yesenia, MJ, they get ready. They start walking simultaneously to this wall, drop off their suitcase, look at each other, and just keep walking. It's like this whole synchronized movement. I feel like I'm watching the beginning of a music video. And I just want to know, are we supposed to believe like that just naturally happened, that they just did this perfect blocking? It was very funny to me. And then when they sit down ready to talk to Matt, they're just sitting across from each other, staring at each other in the eye, in each other's souls, and just go at it. You know Matt's about to come in there. So I would just be smiling, acting so oblivious, and be like, oh, hey, Matt, we were just talking. She said she's gonna miss me so much when she goes home. Oh yeah, I'll go with you. And y'all, the trailer for next week we see Tyler Cameron, we see Heather, we see that Yesenia is going to stay because there was a couple clips with her in it. People are fighting with Katie for exposing them. There's tears. It's just all of the things. Clearly, this episode was just setting us up for all the drama that is about to happen now that most of the bullies are gone. But anyways, thank you guys so much for watching this review and recap of The Bachelor. Help me please turn this monologue into some dialogue by letting me know your thoughts of this season so far and this crazy episode. I will see you in just a few days with my next upload. Bye!